General Odierno really needs no introduction. He's the Army Chief of Staff, and you've got a little bio of him in your programs. Beyond all of that, he's a very, very nice man, an intelligent man, a great soldier, someone all of us could be very proud of, and so we're thrilled to be able to have a good conversation with you. And this is going to be relatively simple. I'm going to ask a few questions, and then at some point I'll open it up to your questions. Stand up, you get a microphone, introduce yourself, and you can ask the general a question or two or whatever. And hopefully an hour from now when we conclude this, we'll all be a little bit smarter thanks to you. We have X amount of knowledge right now, but we'll have X plus knowledge when we leave in an hour. So since I'm a news kind of guy, I'm going to start off with a few newsy questions, and then we'll move on to some more substantive future of war type questions. It's hard to believe it's almost 25 years since Operation Desert Shield and Operation Desert Storm, and you served in Operation Desert Shield, Operation Desert Storm, the liberation of Kuwait. I was then a CNN's Pentagon correspondent, so I remember it very vividly as well. Here's a quote from the chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff on January 23, 1991, General Colin Powell, right at the start of the air war. Quote, our strategy is to go after this army in very, our strategy to go after this army is very, very simple. First, we're going to cut it off, and then we're going to kill it. That's exactly what the U.S. did. A few weeks, 4 weeks of an air war, 4 weeks of a ground war, whatever it took, Kuwait was liberated. Is that kind of talk still relevant today if you were told, go ahead and liberate Mosul from ISIS?
Yeah. So, no, it's not that simple. I think people have learned from not only Desert Shield, Desert Storm, but I'd even go back to 2003 when we very quickly were able to defeat the Iraqi army again and liberate Baghdad very quickly. So when we go against a conventional army against us, I think we're really successful. The problem is people have watched us do this. And so our adversaries understand that maybe they don't want to face us in that way. So we've seen war evolve. And so now it's much more complex, much more difficult. No uniforms, not sure what motivations are. So it is a much more complex, difficult solution set that is now needed. Now, could that happen again? You could make an argument that it could happen in some places around the world. But I believe even if there was a conventional threat against us, there would be a lot of asymmetric pieces to it.
And Colin Powell also promised in that same speech, and I remember it vividly, he promised the United States was going to, and its coalition partners, were going to rip up the Iraqi Air Force in its entirety. It's hard to believe that kind of talk was then, but it's unlikely to hear that kind of talk right now. So if the President of the United States, the Commander-in-Chief, says to you, General Odierno, go ahead and get rid of ISIS in Mosul, what do you do?
Well, we would go in and we would conduct significant ground operations supported by the other domains, space, cyber, air, sea, land, whatever we needed to go do this. But the problem is it's not an enemy that stands out with a uniform and an order of battle. It is an enemy that hides in the population, that uses suicide attacks, that uses techniques that simply are not conventional in any way. So we have to have a force that is able to combat that kind of thing. And so we have some experience in that. I think we would be able to do it, but it would be different than just defeating armored columns and air forces and other things. We'd have to go in and really defeat them among a population that is not part of ISIS. And that's what makes it difficult, because you want to separate the population. I always say you want to separate the reconcilables from the irreconcilables. And that makes it very difficult as you conduct operations like this.
Because Mosul is a huge city of about 2 million people, the second largest city in Iraq right now. The ISIS fighters, they came in there and took it over relatively easily. The Iraqi army, even though they had U.S. equipment, U.S. training, hundreds of billions of dollars in U.S. taxpayer money that was spent building up that military, they simply threw their weapons away, they ran away, and the ISIS fighters took all those U.S. weapons. It was a sad, deplorable moment.
It was. I mean, it's about will. You know, it's not just about having the capability to fight. It's about believing in what you're fighting in. And I think some of the political things that had gone on in Iraq, the movement of commanders, the changing of who was there and why they were fighting, I think if you don't have the will, you don't fight as hard. And so I think that's part of it. And so I think, as you said, it wasn't that they didn't know how to fight. They didn't fight. They left. And so that's problematic. And in a war such as this, or an operation such as this, it is going to be difficult. It's going to take time. And you need soldiers and leaders who are dedicated to finishing this. And that's probably one of the most important pieces as you begin an operation such as liberating Mosul.
Because this is going to require not just street to street, but house to house combat. So if the U.S. objective is to degrade and ultimately destroy ISIS, which the president says is the U.S. objective, but he also says no U.S. combat ground troops, who is going to degrade and ultimately destroy ISIS?
Well, I think it has to be Iraqi security forces, and as you know, to include the Peshmerga forces in the north. And they're going to have to conduct the operations. And I think one of the lessons that I think we should have learned is that it's important to have indigenous capability involved in this, because this is really about their country. Now, it's important to us because of the threat that ISIS, ISIL presents to our regional partners as well as us internationally. So it's important for us to assist in any way we can. But I think it's important that they do this. Now, what we'll have to determine as we go through this is how much support do they really need. And as this goes forward, we'll have to make recommendations on how much support the U.S. needs to give to be successful. But this is going to take time. This is not going to be a short-term issue. It's going to take a lot of time.
We heard a briefing from U.S. Military Central Command the other day saying we're talking about March or April or in the spring offensive, Iraqi troops going in there basically, backed by maybe Kurdish troops. I assume the Shiite militias backed by Iran and some U.S. and coalition air power are going to go liberate Mosul. Is that the game plan?
Well, I mean, I think the game plan is to have Iraqi security forces.
You have confidence
to go into this? Well, I think we're seeing great progress. And over the last couple days, last week, we see them do some successful operations in western Iraq and Anbar province. So they have made some improvements. What we'll have to see is wait and see. Now, We will wait and see what the timeline is, and I leave that up to the commanders on the ground to determine, you know, working with the Iraqis, are they ready to do this or not? But this is not going to be a 3-day, 4-day, 5-day effort. It's going to be months upon months to do this, because it's a very difficult, difficult situation. You can go in there, and as you said, street to street, house to house, identifying who's who, because what you don't want to do is a problem is you don't want to alienate the population that's there, because then your operation it will not be successful. So you've got to understand all of that as you go into
but these these ISIS militants, these fighters, they have a lot of U.S. equipment now. They can booby trap a lot of buildings, IEDs, and all kinds of roads and bridges if they want. From a military standpoint, how good are they?
Well, I would say first, a lot of the equipment they've got, they've since kind of lost and abandoned, and we've been able to affect that.
So they're with air power.
Yeah, the piece that I think is important to them is that, frankly, they'll do anything. I mean, there is no limit to what they would do in order to survive. That's really what's different, and we've watched this evolve over the last 10 years. They could have hundreds of suicide bombers. They could have booby trap buildings. They could have all kinds of things. You know, and the suicide bombers are everything from men to old women to young children, and so. This type of warfare is something that is despicable to us, but it's something that's very natural to them, and that's what makes this challenging. And that's why you have to be prepared and understand and learn. A lot of this is about understanding how they're organized, where they're at, where their strongholds are. So it's about not only the active, aggressive offensive action, it's about having the right intelligence. It's about understanding where they are and how do you cut off their money and how do you make it difficult for them to move inside of Mosul. And so it's all those kind of things that you have to be able to do. And so it is a difficult operation. That's why it's going to take time.
And this number that was thrown out the other day at this Pentagon briefing, 25 or 30,000 troops going into Mosul to liberate that city. Is that a realistic number?
I think so. I think it is a realistic number. I think what you're going to need is, you know, their numbers, you know, the numbers of ISIS vary. Some people say it's 5,000 in there, 2,000, 3,000. We're not sure. But again, what it goes back to is it's not that there's 5,000 fighters lined up. It's 5,000 fighters intermixed among the population and who use incredibly unconventional methods in order to be successful. Because for them, it's about making this operation as long as possible. It's about inflicting as many casualties as possible. And it's about going after the will of the military forces that they're facing. So for them, it's not necessarily you have to absolutely defeat. It is about stretching this out. It's about making the population suffer. It's about inflicting casualties on the enemy. So you got to be prepared for that as you go in.
And are they still successful in recruiting new members?
So I think that, you know, the one thing I'll say is their ability to use social media and promote on the internet is, I think they are still recruiting, and I think they are recruiting from many different parts of the world. And so I do believe that's something that is going on. And I think one of the reasons why it's important that we take this threat seriously is we want to stop this now. We don't want this to continue to grow over time.
And will the Arab countries in the region join in this operation? I know you want the Iraqi military, and you think this new government of Haider al-Abadi is better than Nouri al-Maliki, and that they may be more secure, a stronger government, right, than the previous government. But will other Arab countries in the region actually get involved on the ground, whether Jordan, UAE, Kuwait, Saudi Arabia, Egypt?
So remember that when you're talking about ISIS and ISIL, it's really in two countries. It's in Iraq and Syria. And so it's not just defeating them in Iraq, it's defeating them in Syria. So I think where we've built the major part of the coalition and to support is in Syria. And I think that's an important part of this as well. So part of it is getting into Mosul, which I think should be done by Iraqi security force, a sovereign nation solving a problem inside of their own country.
So there's no indication Jordan's going to go into Iraq.
But I'm not sure we want that. I think we would rather have them focus, as we begin to train the Syrian army, free army, I think that's when we want help from Jordan and other places that are willing to come in and help us, because we are going to have to also remember that you have ISIS operating in Syria, and we don't want them to have a safe haven. So if you defeat them in Mosul, they just run into Syria. And so, you know, that's an important part of this as we go forward as well.
I asked the question because, as you know, the president of Egypt, El-Sisi, he wants to create this, you know, pan-Arab ground force, if you will.
Well, I think it's important. I think for the first time in the last couple of weeks, we've seen Jordan, king has been very clear about this for a long time, but I think you've now seen the people of Jordan very clear that they want to do something against ISIS. Now we have Egypt that's come out and said, we got to do something about ISIS. So we're starting to see the leaders in the Middle East starting to coalesce around, this is a problem that we have to deal with. I think that's important. And I think that'll be very important as we move forward, because we need them all to be involved. So I think we want to be able to build a coalition that wants to assist, because that's, in my mind, without that, it's always going to be difficult to rid ourselves of this threat.
A few technical points, and then I'm going to move on. The Peshmerga, the Kurdish fighters, they're friendly to the United States. They're loyal. They're fierce. But they don't have the weaponry they need. Sometimes we've shown video. They're using World War II artillery pieces. The weapons the United States provides the Kurds still goes through the central government in Baghdad, and eventually some of it trickles up to the Kurds. Why not provide the weapons directly
to
the Kurds?
Well, again, I would just say I think the Peshmerga are part of the Iraqi security forces. We're honoring the sovereignty of Iraq by providing them the equipment so they can then provide it to the Peshmerga. We have paid a lot more attention to the Peshmerga in terms of training. We have a lot of European allies who are helping the Peshmerga as well. And so I think that's starting to show some progress. And I think we're starting to increase their capability.
Now, the U.S. has provided over the last couple of months a lot of military equipment to the Iraqi army, thousands of weapons specifically. Are you confident those weapons will remain in the hands of the Iraqi military, that they won't wind up in the hands of ISIS, as a lot of other U.S. military equipment.
I think as we're doing the training this time, we are very focused on making sure the units we are putting together are going to stay together and stick together. Now, I can never guarantee 100% that they will stick together, but I think part of the training we're doing is ensuring that they build confidence in themselves and they have the confidence and will to conduct the operations.
So you're upbeat about that. Here's what troubles me as a U.S. taxpayer. The U.S. taxpayers are paying for all these weapons that we're giving to the Iraqi military. Iraq is an OPEC member, an oil exporting country. They've got money. Why aren't they purchasing these weapons? Why are we just giving them millions and millions of dollars worth of...
Well, first, they have purchased billions of dollars worth of equipment from the United
States.
But
the most recent...
I understand that. But they have spent billions of dollars of their own money purchasing equipment. The tanks and the artillery pieces that they had gotten were all purchased by their dollars. F-16s that they're still in the process of being purchased by their dollars. So this is not completely, we're giving them everything. Yes, at a time of emergency, we are providing them some additional weapons, but they have, in fact, purchased and spent billions on weapons.
Will we ask them to reimburse us at
some point? Well, I don't know. We'll work through that. I think at some time we'll have this discussion about that they will have to start paying for some of this stuff.
One question on Syria, the Free Syrian Army. The U.S. is vetting a lot of these guys to go train, whether in Jordan or Turkey or Saudi Arabia or someplace. Any of them started training yet, or is the vetting process still going
on? Very close. So we expect March. We expect somewhere in March, April timeframe, March hopefully, that we will begin to train.
And then how long will that training last?
So they're still working through it, but it'll probably be somewhere around 4 or 6 weeks. And then we're going to form units, and then we'll go from there. We're still, we'll develop this as we go, depending on how well they do. But there's a good plan in place, and I think it's going to start pretty quickly
units, these Free Syrian Army units, are we training them to go after the Syrian regime of Bashar al-Assad, his military, or to go after ISIS in Syria?
So our intention is, our initial problem is ISIS and ISIL. So these units are being built to help us to put pressure on ISIS, and we want to put pressure on from multiple fronts, and this allows us to open another front against ISIL, and so that's the intent of us training these forces.
The other day there was a warning to all American citizens in Kabul, and the defense secretary, the new one, Ash Carter, he was just in Kabul, to basically be on the lookout. It's an extremely dangerous environment right now in the Afghan capital. Militants plan, this is from the State Department warning, militants plan to conduct multiple imminent attacks against an unspecified target or targets in Kabul City. What's going on there?
Well, I would just say this is something that we've seen over time. And there's probably some intelligence that says there are some large terrorist attacks getting ready to occur, attempt to be done in Kabul. So what this means is, for the most part, is the Taliban and associated organizations are frankly not moving forward the way they want. So what they want to do is it's important for them to create the perception that the Afghan government is failing, that their security forces are not doing the job they're supposed to do. So that's when we start, my experience in both Iraq and Afghanistan tell me that's when you start to see these threats, because they're worried, because I think they're seeing the effectiveness of President Ghani and the government and how they're starting to form and coalesce and the relationship they're building with Pakistan. And I think this is all concerned. So what they want to try to do is disrupt that. And so I think you'll start to see potential threats of large attempt to conduct large terrorist activities inside of Kabul to make it look like the government is trying to destabilize the government.
See, when I read that State Department advisory, it sounded to me like they were deeply concerned about the U.S. Embassy.
Well, Kabul. I mean, I think it's all, I would argue, and if you can get the U.S. Embassy, again, that shows they're not able to do certain things, and it creates some doubt about the government. So that's why they try to attack those types of targets.
The whole region, and I've studied the Middle East for a long time, North Africa, South Asia, Middle East, it seems to be on fire right now.
Well, I think you have a lot of things going on. I mean, I think you have this idea of moderates versus extremists, or however else you want to define it. That's going on, that underpin, and my experience over there tells me that 99% of Islamic faith of moderates, and but you have a portion that is not, and so you have this conflict that's going on inside of that, and then underlying all this, you have the Sunni Shia competition that's going on. Some would say for hegemony in the Middle East. So I think it's a combination of all of those things that are happening. The other thing that's happened over the last 5 to 6, 7 years is with information being more readily available to the peoples of these countries, they are looking for more say in their governments, and so you're having governmental issues, which actually makes it easier for organizations like ISIS and ISIL and Al-Qaeda and others to try to take advantage of this. So you're seeing this play out in front of us. And I think that's why you're seeing all this turmoil inside of the Middle East.
Because Yemen has turned out to be a disaster.
Well, and you have, again, Shia, Sunnis, Al-Qaeda mixed in, a failing government or a government that doesn't have complete control. And so it is a recipe for them to try to exploit that. And we've seen that in other areas. You've seen it in Libya. You see it, we see it in Africa as well. So I mean, that's the kind of environment that they try to take advantage of. And that's so that's why it's important that we understand that and that we have a coalition within the Middle East to fight this kind of problem.
The AQAP, Al-Qaeda in the Arabian Peninsula in Yemen, with the U.S. Embassy shut down, U.S. troops by and large gone, Americans out of there, too dangerous. What's going to happen to AQAP in Yemen?
Well, I think we're going to have to watch and see. I mean, I think we're not completely out. We're still conducting some operations there, and so we will continue to do that. And we'll watch that very carefully. And again, for us, it's about trying to get a government in place that can stabilize Yemen, and that's going to take some work.
So the U.S. Embassy shut down in Sana'a, Yemen. The U.S. Embassy shut down in Libya, right? That the U.S. with a coalition got rid of Gaddafi amid high expectations. This is going to be a new era in Libya. That didn't turn out so well. What happened?
Well, I think first off, as you eliminate governments, you've got to have something that fills that void. And I think one of the things we have to rethink as we do these operations is what happens after. And we've got to, and that's a whole government problem.
It's not just the U.S.
It's just
Army.
It's just not the military. Yeah. It's got to be a multinational effort. It's got to be a interagency effort, diplomatically, economically, militarily, that helps to solve this. And so, but we can't take on every one of these ourselves. We got to have help from the international community as well. And that's why it's important for us to build this coalitions that can solve this problem.
Because if you take a look at Yemen, Libya, Somalia, the U.S. Embassy shut down in Somalia right now, obviously in Damascus, Syria as well. When I say the region seems to be on fire, there's a potential there for this to simply further escalate right now, right? Not get better.
I mean, there is, listen, we don't know what's going to happen, but it certainly is. I tell everybody it's the most uncertain I've seen the environment in my almost 40 years in the Army. So I'm not saying it's the most dangerous, but certainly incredibly uncertain.
All right, a couple other areas in the world I want to get your thoughts. Europe right now, Ukraine. How worried are you about what's going on in eastern Ukraine and the potential revival of a Cold War?
Yeah. So, I mean, I think we all should be worried about what's going on in Ukraine. I think I'm not sure how well we truly understand the devastation that's happened inside of eastern Ukraine. The damage and the destruction that's occurred. And so, that's not the kind of thing we want in Europe. I think it's important for us to understand the impact this could have on our NATO partners. And I think the one thing it does is waking up NATO a little bit to understand that we have to be prepared. And so what we want to do is we want to de-escalate, we don't want to escalate. But it is something that is concerning to all of us as we've watched what's happened. And it's almost a new type of warfare. It's a mixture of asymmetric, cyber, conventional use of proxies that is being done here by the Russia. And is this a new way to conduct operations? And so I think we have to watch this very carefully and learn from it, especially as we think about what we might have to face in the future. So I think it's important for us to take a hard look at this. And I think For us, we have to pay attention to what's going on in Ukraine. And, you know, we are having discussions. We do have military-to-military interaction with Ukraine, but it's, you know, at a very, you know, at times of exchanging ideas and things like that. And I think we have to watch this, because it's going to have an impact. It could have an impact on Eastern Europe specifically.
NATO allies. And Article 5 stipulates that if one NATO ally is attacked, all NATO allies.
So we've been doing very aggressive exercise programs now for the last year in Eastern Europe. And we're rotating forces in Estonia, Latvia, Lithuania, Poland. We're working very closely with them. For the first time in 20 years, we deployed a heavy brigade for a period of time to help to do joint exercises with them in Eastern Europe.
With tanks?
Yes, with tanks. And we're talking about pre-positioning those tanks over there, leaving them there so we can rotate forces. We'll see. We're working this within NATO. We have significantly increased our exercise program inside of NATO. Making sure we're increasing our interoperability. This is going to go on, and I think we're going to continue to build this capability, and it's important for us to continue to do that.
Because the other day I was interviewing General George Jalwan, the former NATO Supreme Allied Commander, and he pointed out the U.S. removed all its battle tanks from Germany with the end of the Cold War. Is that right?
Well, we did, but we left a small amount in storage. We've now sent a whole brigade's worth of equipment. We're in the process of putting a whole brigade's of heavy equipment back over there that we'll keep there in case we need it and to rotate for training. And so we have reacted to that, and we've been doing that actually for some time now.
Because a lot of us are confused by Putin. I'm sure you are. Everybody who sees what he's doing. The other day, British Royal Air Force jets intercepted Russian bombers off the coast of Britain. I mean, what's going on?
Well, I don't know. I will say I'm like you. I don't understand exactly what President Putin is thinking. I would just say that we have to understand that they have taken aggressive a stance in Ukraine, in Eastern Ukraine. We're not sure what their goals are in Ukraine, and we're not sure what the impacts could be on the other Eastern European allies. So we have to be working within NATO to be prepared. Now, I think also that, again, that I believe the future of all this type of warfare is something that's going to require joint interagency work and multinational coalitions. And I think this is an important part of this. And I think we have a standing coalition in NATO that we have to work together militarily, and then you have to have the diplomatic political issues being done by both NATO and the EU working and the United States working with them. And I think all of those are going to be important as we move forward here, and we have to consider all that.
Because what's a little concerning, I'm sure to you as well, is the disagreements. There's always been disagreements among NATO allies. But in terms of arming the Ukrainian military, some serious disagreements, let's say, between Germany on the one hand, the U.S. on the other hand.
Yeah, but I would just say I think this is good discussion. I really mean that when I say that. I think this is a situation that we want to, what I always worry about in history, it's always about miscalculation. And so what you don't want to do is have a huge miscalculation that immediately escalates problems in Europe. And so I think it's important that we try different types of ideas, we listen to each other, and I think that'll help us to form where we need to go. But what you can't do is you got to be prepared. And so from a military perspective, what I want to make sure is we are increasing our preparedness within NATO in case that option is needed sometime in the future.
All right, so we got a mess in the Middle East, North Africa. We got real serious tensions in Europe right now, potentially a revival of the Cold War. Let's hope that doesn't happen. What also worries me, and I'm sure you as well, is the Korean Peninsula right now, because the uncertainty there. People forget, the U.S. still has, almost 30,000 troops along the demilitarized zone between North and South Korea. And I noticed the other day, a Johns Hopkins analyst, Joel Witt, I went to Johns Hopkins, so I full disclosure, he pointed out that by 2020, North Korea could have, in his estimate, between 20 and 100 nuclear bombs. He believes they already have 10 to 16. Is that true?
I have not seen that, so I would not verify that But here's what I would say is what you're, the thing we watch is the ballistic missile threat, because that's what gives you capability, if they ever happen to have the capability to have nuclear weapons, is their ability to deliver those. And so I think what you're seeing is you can sort of see provocation from North Korea trying to show that they might have some capability. And so it is concerning. And I always worry when you have a nation that has other problems, significant economic problems, unable to feed its population, what it might be willing to do to survive. And so I think we always have to be very concerned about that. For us, it's important that we continue to build on the strong partnership we have with South Korea. It's important that we try to ensure that we, again, don't have miscalculation because of provocations that occur between North Korea and South Korea. And I think it's important for us to make sure we kind of keep that in the box. But we also have to make sure that we have the ability to respond very quickly. I mean, you know, the thing about Korea is the amount of people there are within artillery range of North Korea in Seoul. You know, millions upon millions of people, and oh, by the way, hundreds of thousands of Americans that are there. And so that, you know, that's always a big concern. And so we want to make sure that there's not over-provification that causes an initial exchange that we start seeing casualty, which could then escalate. And anything, and you know, and then does it escalate? And then you might, does China get involved? Does the U.S. get, I mean, this is very serious business. So it's important for us first to continue to work with the governments within Asia to try to ensure diplomatically that North Korea, as best we can, try to influence them to not over-provocate and miscalculate, but it's also incumbent on us to ensure we have the right military capability there. And that's why we keep that many thousands of individuals on the peninsula.
And they're staying there.
Yeah, well, we're rotating capabilities. So what we're changing is we're now going to rotate forces there, which I think is actually going to improve
what does that
our
mean,
readiness.
What do you,
so we used to have, so we, there was a brigade permanently assigned there. So what we're now doing is we're taking brigades from the United States and they will rotate there for a year at a time and replace each other. What that allows us to do is train them here and then make sure they're highly trained and capable and send them over there. And we'll do that with both our ground and some of our rotary wing aviation.
Well, we're still going to keep about 30,000
troops. But the same amount of people will always be on the ground.
Along the DMZ. I mean, I spent 6 days in North Korea 4 years ago. And what impressed me was, and I met with some of their military leaders, and they seemed to be pretty sophisticated. They seemed to know what was going on outside of North Korea. I was listened to them. I thought maybe they were living in another world, but they weren't. They were right. Pretty sophisticated. They monitor the international news media. They watch CNN, you know, so they knew what was going on. But what worries me is I don't know that much about Kim Jong-un. I don't know, right. You know, what he's all about. I know he's thinking of going to Moscow in a few months for his first visit as leader outside of North Korea. What can you tell us about him?
Well, we don't know much about him either. The workings of the senior leadership of the North Korean military is not as greatly known as we'd like it to be, obviously. So we don't know what they're thinking. We don't know who's part of the decision-making process. What we do know is, though, that they are sophisticated. They are working asymmetric issues. They have a large special operations force. They have large conventional forces. They're developing ballistic missiles, so you know they are a serious threat that you have to understand that they have developed capability over time, and they study this every single day. So this is not something that they take, you know, they are focused totally on the Korean Peninsula, and so they, you know, that for many, many years. So you got to understand that they are fairly sophisticated in how they might conduct operations, and so we should not ever take the North Koreans lightly in terms of military capability.
Well, we're talking about the future of war. And one key aspect of the future of war is cyber warfare. North Koreans, you know, I didn't think they had a very good cyber warfare capability, but I seem to have been wrong if, in fact, they did what the U.S. says they did to Sony Pictures.
Yeah, well, if you think about it, you know, cyber is a relatively inexpensive way to attack and influence outside of your borders. And so to invest in it and to develop expertise is something that you see many nations potentially trying to do. So I think it's something we have to take very seriously, and I think we are. You know, as we look to the future, as I think about the future, one of the real challenges that we have and what we have to focus on is what I call a synchronizing and integrating cross-domain warfare. What do I mean by that? That is about integrating and synchronizing effects from air, space, cyberspace, sea, land, and bring effects. So for the Army, it's our responsibility to integrate and synchronize that and be able to use that to bring effects on the ground. And it's both non-lethal and lethal effects, and you should have different spectrums of this capability. So it starts out small and can grow and grow and grow, so you provide lots of options for our national security leaders. So for me, that's something that we have to think about. Now, cyber is I would argue it's a new form of maneuver in military terms. And so we have to be able to understand and do that. So our ability to develop cyber capabilities, national level cyber capabilities, operational and tactical cyber capabilities are very important to the future of warfare. And I think that we are doing that. We have reorganized ourselves in the Army. We now have an Army Cyber Command. We've now developed a Center of Excellence. We've created a new career field for cyber. We have a cyber institute at West Point that's dealing with educational institutions and private companies. So this is important, and we are investing in this. Even with our budgets going down, we are investing in this cyber. So it's very important.
Because they could shut us down if cyber warfare activity.
They potentially could go after our infrastructure. They could go after many things. And so I think we have to be very aware. Now, inside, I would just say from a military perspective, we are limited. We are limited by authorities. Part of this is a debate that we have to have here in this country and internationally on how you deal with this, because there are limits because of freedoms and other laws that are in place. So that's an important discussion that has to constantly go on as this threat evolves on how we might be able to respond. That's part of this as well as we go to talk about the future.
So because if potentially, if we're looking at a war in 10 years, an enemy, if the U.S. Army were going to go into battle, they could launch some cyber attack and prevent you from doing any kind of battle, if you will.
Right. So we have to be able to. I mean, they could conduct a cyber attack which takes out all our electronic capability, or takes out our ability to communicate, or takes out radars or whatever. And so we have to be prepared.
Are we prepared for that?
We have to be prepared. We work very hard on that regularly. We have to be prepared to defend that. And then we have to figure out, in my mind, as we think about the future, I believe technology, you know, we used to depend on a large technological advantage, that we would always have great technological advantage. I still think we can build technological advantage, but I believe the time that we have this advantage is going to be shortened because of the proliferation of technology is so much faster today. So for me, and it gets to cyber, it has to do with not so much do you have a technological advantage, but how adaptive and innovative are we in using that technology? And for me, that's the important thing in the future, that we have to develop leaders and capability that allow us to be more adaptive and innovative in using technological advances as we develop new concepts for us to be successful. And that's what we're focusing on. And so I want to develop leaders who are comfortable and being adaptable and innovative and flexible and being able to react and being able to use technology in new ways that enables us to sustain a significant advantage over adversaries.
And in terms of cyber warfare threats, potential threats, who represents the biggest threat to the United States? And you can mention countries, or you could mention non-countries, terrorist organizations, if you will.
Well, I would just say any one of our major adversaries, you know, whether it be Russia, China, Iran, Korea, I would tell you that they're developing cyber capability. How much and how good they are at it, I won't comment on that. But they are developing it. And clearly, we watch ISIS today. And part of cyber is their ability, you watch how they use the social media in order to get their message out. It's quite sophisticated. And so that's the beginning, although that's not cyber attacks per se, that's the beginning of using technology in order for them to proliferate their message to many different groups, is the next step now developing some cyber capability. So we should assume that all our adversaries, whether they be state or non-state actors, are attempting to develop some level of cyber capability to come after us or whoever else they want to attack.
It raises a great question. ISIS, AQAP, Al-Shabaab, very good social media. They're recruiting, they're getting their propaganda out there. Has there been any evidence that they have attempted cyber warfare?
I don't know. I don't want to comment on that.
Because you only need, you know, 20 or 30 guys,
yeah. I mean,
19, 20
years
old.
Here's what I would just say to that question. Is I would just say, I would assume they're trying to develop that capability. I mean, I think we should just make that assumption, that they're going to try to do that, and they will try to use that if they think they can. As I said, it's a cheaper, simpler way to go after somebody. So I think we should at least, whether they are or not, we need to believe they are trying to develop that capability.
Why are they better at social media than we are?
Well, I think, first off,
we invented it.
Yeah, but I would just say, so from a governmental standpoint, and let me take it from a military standpoint, we are held to some higher standards of how you use social media. They do whatever they want. And what they put on social media, is it truthful, is it not truthful, it doesn't matter. They are not held to any standard. And so for us, you know, we are held to very specific standards as we put things out on social media. So I think that's the difference, and it makes it a bit easier. Now, I'm not making an excuse. I think we can be much better in social media than we are.
What's the future of the conventional U.S. Army?
So what I think a couple things. I think warfare is evolving. I think when I talk about the Army of the future, I talk about three things. We have to be able to prevent, shape, and win. So one of the first thing we got to be able to do is prevent conflict. And we got to help the combatant commanders around the world, whether it be in Asia, Middle East, Europe. We have to help them to prevent conflict. And so you need some level of capability and capacity conventionally that will help deter and compel others from doing things. So I think that's first. That's the first reason you need it. The second piece in the future is that I think warfare is evolving in such a way, I'm not convinced that we're going to have another war where we have 250,000 people. But what I do believe is because of the velocity of instability, as you said, is increasing. And what that means is a couple of things. We have to be able to respond quicker because the instability happens faster and reaction has to be quicker. So we have to be able to probably do simultaneous smaller operations around the world. Today, we have named operations on 5 separate continents going on today. So in the future, what we have to be able to do as an army is move very quickly in order to provide a multi-cross-domain capability to provide effects on the ground. And so although it might not be 150,000 in one place, it could be 15, 20,000 in 5 different places. And I would argue that's actually more difficult because you have to understand the region that you're in. You have to understand 5 separate regions. So you have to develop expertise in those areas. You have to have a force that can be capable of operating in several different environments. I often joke, and you mentioned about the Cold War earlier, when I was a young officer in the 80s, 70s and 80s, with the Cold War, in a lot of ways it was much simpler. We knew exactly who our enemy was. It was the Soviet Union. We knew where we were going to fight them in Europe. We knew what capabilities they had. We knew exactly where we were going to be. Today and in the future, we're not going to have that. Mm-hmm. We got to be able to respond to many different places not necessarily known. So that requires us to be more adaptable and flexible. We have to have organizations that are more adaptable and flexible. What makes the Army different than the Navy and the Air Force, I would say, with platform-centric, is the Army's about developing people who operate in organizations to gain effects on the ground. And so for us, we got to develop our individuals, our leaders, and our soldiers, and then we got to organize them in ways that enable them to be effective in gaining effects on the ground. And so we have to be able to do that maybe in Korea, maybe in Iraq, maybe in Syria, maybe in Eastern Europe, maybe you know, pick your place around the world where we might have to use them. And so all of those are very different environments. So what we have to do is we have to make our soldiers more regionally astute. So we're starting to regionally align forces so they understand regionally what's going on. And they understand it's not just militarily, it's culturally, it's economically. So they understand all the second, third order effects. And I also believe that in the future that what we have to deliver is the ability to integrate and synchronize interagency effects and multinational effects. And so we have done that over the last 10 years, but we have to do it much better than we have. And so we have to not only be able to synchronize all our military capabilities, it's got to be synchronized with other agencies, State Department, Treasury, FBI, whatever. And then we have to be able to work with our multinational partners. So we got to be comfortable in that environment. And some of the things I talk about is we want to develop a network, a network of capability around the world, a land network, that we have nodes that enable us to work with our multinational partners, and that we understand what's going on in each region. We connect those to each other in order for us to conduct operations depending on where we might have to do. And that's just, I'm talking about small amounts of people, but it enables us to understand that environment much better because we're going to have to respond very quickly. So I see us doing many things initially with smaller capability. And then what we want to do is provide our national security leaders options, both lethal and non-lethal options, in order to solve that problem.
Because the U.S. Army, as you know, is shrinking.
Right.
Some numbers. During the Cold War, it was, you know, huge, obviously. But after 9/11, 579,000 U.S. Army active duty troops. Right now, 517,000. It's going to go down if the forced budget cut sequestration fully goes into effect. 420,000 soldiers in the U.S. Army. That's pretty low number. That's not good enough from your perspective.
So we're actually at about 500,000 today. We'll be at 490 by the end of this year. Our plan is to be at 450 by the end of 18, and if sequestration goes into effect, we'd be at 420 by about 2020. So there's two problems we have right now. One is the near-term problem is that because the budget's going down, we're sacrificing readiness and modernization until we can get the end strength to the level we need. And the reason I can't do it any faster is because we have a lot of commitments around the world still today. And then as you get to 2020, if we go to 420, I would argue that the problem is now capacity. And so do we have the capacity to do simultaneous operations on several continents in order to solve this growing instability that we're seeing around the world? So I think that's the concern with sequestration. I'll be frank, I'm not into comparing numbers between now and in the 90s and 80s because our formations are much more capable than they were then. That said, I am concerned about where we're going and the size of where we're going. And I think we have said at 450, I believe we can execute the strategy the president has established at 450,000, but it's tenuous. And that's assuming that all the assumptions are right and we don't have unknown things happening. And so that becomes the challenge. And so we are concerned about that. But for me, as I look to the future, I can't be focused on just, okay, are we going to be 550, 490, 450, 420? I got to start thinking about how are we going to, whatever size you are, how are we going to use that force to be effective?
So where does the National Guard and the Army Reserve?
Yeah, so today, the National Guard, so the National Guard is about 350,000, the Reserve is about 200,000. After sequestration, there will be 315,000 in the Guard and about 185,000. So you're talking about a significant reduction in the size of our Army from 2011 to 2020 when this is finished.
So is that going to endanger national security?
So I believe it depends, you know, again, it depends on what the environment is. And I would just say right now, the unpredictability of the environment, in my mind, raises the risk significantly to the security of the nation if we go to those small numbers.
I know there's going to be some questions from the audience, so get ready. We'll get you a microphone. You can identify yourself. But before I take some questions from the audience, you're a soldier, 38 years in the United States Army. Overnight, we learned that in the American Sniper trial, as it's called, the killer was convicted, and sentenced to life in prison without the possibility of parole. Two American soldiers dead, obviously. So when you hear that, and you hear about post-traumatic stress, and you hear about, you know, three military guys, two dead, one's going to be now in prison for the rest of his life, and you wonder, what was the impact of war on these three individuals?
Yeah.
What went through your mind?
Well,
when
I
assume you saw the movie.
I have not seen it, actually. But I'm very familiar with it. Here's what I would say. First, it's important for people to understand that warfare is difficult. It's chaotic. It's stressful. And there's two things I would take out of this. Again, I have not seen the movie. But first of all, think of the decisions that he had to make. Those are very difficult decisions. And those things weigh on you. So I think we should always understand that warfare is something that's very difficult. In fact, sometimes I get a bit frustrated. I have a lot of people tell me, well, you're in the military. You guys like going to war. If you've ever been to war, you never want to go to war again. We know what it means. We know the sacrifice involved in it. That's why the reason we have a military is to prevent war, not to have a war. And so what I would say is it's important for people to understand that there are impacts on our soldiers as they come back. But what I worry about, Wolf, is that people think every soldier that comes back has big problems. Most people overcome these problems. A lot of them don't have them at all, but many of them overcome it. And what I would just tell you is we need to take care of them. But you don't take care of them by feeling sorry for them. You take care of them by giving them the opportunity to continue their lives. And we should go out of our way to make sure that they are able to continue their lives, because I believe America owes that to these young men and women. And so that's what I think about. I worry that, first of all, it's important for people to understand the stress that they're under and what it means to be at war. But secondly, it should be that people can recover from this, we have to invest in it, and that we have to give our soldiers opportunities because they can contribute greatly to our society as we move forward.
But there's no doubt that a lot of men and women who served, whether in Iraq they're still suffering today.
Absolutely, and they will. This is going to go on for 10, 15, 20 years. This is not going to stop, but we have to recognize that, and we have to invest in that.
Okay, I agree. All right, please get a microphone. I don't know if there are microphones. Yes, and just give us your name, a little identification.
I'm Harlan Ullman, a very old senior naval officer, past. General, thank you for your comments, and Wolf, you are a great interrogator. My question has to do with your successor, General, and his successor. Some of us in the Defense Business Board in particular are arguing that the biggest problem your successor may face is a hollow force. Even if there's no sequestration, even if you keep spending at $600 billion, the inherent cost growth for pay, compensation, retirement for old guys like me, healthcare, new weapon system, we haven't counted a new bomber, et cetera, are going to be astronomical. And Congress is going to be very reluctant for base closing or changes in compensation. What are you going to recommend to your successor as how do you confront this to prevent the U.S. military from becoming a hollow army that you and I recall when we were in it in the 70s and 80s?
Thank you for that. I would just say this is a really important topic. And first off, there's two things I would tell the person following me, is that we have to have the right pay and compensation of all volunteer army. There's ways for us to do this where we can do that and reduce the cost. And we have to work very hard, and we got to continue to press and work with Congress to solve that. The other thing I would say is we have to become, when we develop new systems, they have to be more reliable. And what I mean by that is they should require a lot less maintenance at a lot less cost. And that needs to be something that as we develop new systems that we insist upon. The other piece is we have to be able to invest in ways to train that are cheaper. And so you got to invest in that. We've started all of these programs already, but we're not there. But the one thing I come down to is the number one thing we need to do is develop leaders. Because no matter what happens, if we are developing proper leaders and we are challenging them, I believe we can overcome almost any deficiency. And I think when I first came in the Army, I looked at we had some great leaders and we had some really bad leaders. And that's why we ended up with a hollow army. And what we have to be able to do is make sure we are developing the right leaders who understand these issues, who are helping enable us to adapt and innovate as we go to the future. So the other thing I would say is we're at a very high level now because of the experience that we have and the kind of leaders we have, and we have to be able to keep them, which we are so far. We have to allow them to give them more responsibility, allow them to adapt and innovate, and I think that will help us to ensure we don't get to a hollow army. But people have to realize that the costs are going up, and if costs are going up, you got to invest more dollars. And I think people tend to focus on the top line number instead of what's the percentage that we're spending. And I think we should spend a little bit more time on this percentage of what we're spending on defense compared to the GDP. And I think we tend to forget that, which is lower now than it's been in a very long time. And I think in order, you know, I call the military is like an insurance policy. And people don't like buying expensive insurance and policies until they have to use it. What I worry about is if we don't invest in it and we invest in a low-cost insurance policy, when it comes due and we have to use it, they're not going to be prepared. And when we're not prepared, that means we're sending, the cost will be the lives of our soldiers, sailors, airmen, and Marines. And that's what I worry about as we do this.
One way to make sure you ask a question is to grab the microphone. So thank you very much. I wanted to ask you to follow up on your description of a global network with our partners with multiple nodes. The people at my table smiled because I talk about networks constantly. But what I wanted to ask is, how do we lead in that setting? Because you can't be out front. You're really leading from the center, and it's a different way of leading, and I'd be very interested in your thoughts on how we do that.
And your name and?
Sorry, Anne-Marie Slaughter, CEO of New America.
Good, in case somebody didn't know.
First off, I think the thought process behind this is that because of the complexity of the world, and frankly, the world is becoming more interconnected, that we have to be interconnected as well. And so the thought process is that we can, so NATO's an easy example, but I like to start there. So we already have an alliance that's set in place. So what you do is as part of that alliance, you now build a network of capabilities, whether it's for counterterrorism or whether it's for defending Europe or whether it's for using NATO outside of Europe. You develop relationships and you develop interoperability between your forces so you're capable of doing that. Let's move to Asia. Let's say, so if it's somewhere in Asia, it's a bit different of a problem. You want a network there where we're building some capacity in some of our allies and partners. We are starting to gain access because we're building relationships. It might be access to deliver humanitarian assistance or disaster relief. But what that does, it helps build relationships. It helps to build familiarity, so when you have to work together, it enables you to do it. So what you do is you establish these networks where you are meeting regularly, you are setting goals for each other, you're getting familiar with each other, and then it helps you to solve problems in a more quicker, faster paced way. So that's kind of the thought process. And I think we already have some of this in place, but it's about making it, bringing it to the next step and bringing it forward that I think is really important.
We got a microphone.
Thanks. Yoni Shimshoni from Israel. The U.S. has led, historically, the development of combined arms warfare. And today you took it a step further to combined agency warfare. And I'd like you to, if you could, unpack that and tell us what you mean by that, who would lead that, who would quarterback it in American terms, how would it get analyzed, organized, and executed?
So let me, and I don't want to overstate it because, but how I see this is, let me use what's happened in West Africa as an example, Ebola virus. So there was a lot of non-governmental organizations and other things that were trying to solve the Ebola crisis in Liberia. Now, what we did as a military, we were able to deploy a headquarters over there that was able to integrate all of the different work that was going on. And so we were then able to organize the local governmental entities, the non-governmental entities, and our national entities together to help solve the problem. So now the rate of Ebola virus has plummeted. And so that's the kind. So that's an example of in a humanitarian assistance role, but in a military role. So let's wherever we might go. And it depends on what the environment is. There'll be times when the State Department could lead in this, and there's times where the military would lead. Where we would lead is parts where there's instability and security is not strong. And so we're able to put in a military that's able to organize and bring together all the impacts of joint. So, all the different military aspects. And then we're able to bring in and integrate military operations with our diplomatic efforts and our economic efforts. And we try to bring those together to gain the overall effects that are necessary to solve the problem. Because I believe there are very few problems in the future that are just simply military problems. They're all socioeconomic and military. And so in order to solve that problem, you have to come at it with a more holistic approach. And I think that what we can help bring is help to organize that and start that and then hand it off as we make progress. So that's the thought process behind it. We call it JIM, Joint Interagency Intergovernmental Multinational Solutions.
Yes.
We have to have an acronym for everything.
Take a question from this side too.
Peter Singer with New America General. Thank you for joining us.
Good to see you, Peter.
Good to see you as well. You took us on a tour around the world of the importance of our various training and advisory missions. But then also on the tour, we kept naming places where we had training and advisory missions that hadn't worked out, whether it's Iraq or Yemen, or we used to talk about Mali as an example, and then that didn't work out. So what isn't working, and how do we fix it for the future, given the importance of all of this to the American role in the future of war?
Well, it's persistence, for one thing. You can't, so in Iraq, we were making good progress, and then we couldn't get an agreement and left. So I think that's part of the problem. But it's also establishing the institution itself. So we're good at training the military. We're good at training squads, platoons, companies, battalions, brigades. But we forget about you have to have the institution that supports that. So you have to have the institution that supports leader training. You have to have an institution that supports sustainment. You have to have an institution that's... And so although we were working on that in Iraq, I'll use that as an example because I'm more familiar with that, they weren't ready yet. And so when you leave, it fails. And so they're no longer getting equipment. They're not doing the right training properly because they don't have the institutional ability to do it. And that's why in Afghanistan now, we're really focused on that part of it. That's an important part of what's going on. We're trying to learn from our mistakes so that, and we have to stay engaged. It doesn't mean you have to stay engaged with thousands of people on the ground, but we got to stay engaged because if you don't, it's very easy that they could wander away because of all the political inside issues. Corruption is a problem as well, and that's something you always have to take on in a lot of these nations is the incredible corruption that goes on. And so that takes away. And when we're there, we're kind of like a watchdog over corruption. It still goes on, but maybe not as much. And so it's about embedding those values and embedding the institution that helps solve these problems. And so I think that's where I think we've made mistakes, is that it takes time. It's not apples to apples when I say this, but everybody always says, well, why were we able, why, look at Germany today, look at Korea today, look at Japan today. Well, we invested in those countries and we're still invested in those countries today. And it doesn't have to be, again, with great military numbers, but you got to be invested in them and help to bring them along over a long period of time, because this doesn't happen in 2 or 3 years. It's a much longer, if we want to develop a military capability that's going to be long-lasting, you got to stay engaged with it.
Can I ask a quick follow-up? Sure. How would you assess the institution-building side of the current training programs for Syrian rebels and Iraqis?
We're focusing on the Iraqis, on the institution. It's coming along. We're working with some new players now with a new government, so we're continuing to work that. In Syria, we haven't even started. We're in the basics now in Syria, but that's something as that progresses, we'll have to take that into consideration depending on how that turns out. And that's a different issue, because we're trying to develop them against ISIL. We're not sure what's going to happen within Syria yet, but that'll be something we have to think about as we go forward. In Afghanistan, we are focused on that very much, and with this new government, that's why it's important for us. They got to get those final pieces of the government in place yet. It's not there yet. And then we can really start helping them build that institution.
I know we have a question here.
Colin Cotlin from the London Daily Telegraph. General, you've spoken a lot about the importance of multinational partners. For the past 30 years, Britain, the British military has been a very valuable ally in the wars that we've fought. Looking to the future, and given the very drastic defence cuts we've had in the UK, do you still see Britain as a reliable military partner in the wars of the future? And how important is it for the British government to commit to 2% of GDP for military spending?
Yeah, well, I would say yes. I still see him as a wild partner. We signed an army-to-army agreement about us continuing to work together, integrated, as we move to the future. So we have a kind of a bilateral army agreement between our two armies to continue to work together. And I think what's happened is it's about having a partner that has very close values and goals that we do. But more importantly, what's changed, though, is the level of capability. So it's not capability stuff. It's more about capacity in the British Army. So what we're trying to do now is, how do we readjust and fit? Because we used to, in the past, it'd be a division, a UK division next to a US Army division. Now it might be a UK brigade inside of a US division, or a UK battalion inside of a US brigade. And so we got to adjust our program to make sure we're still able to work together. And I think as we look to the future of the Army, we put out a new Army operating concept. We work very closely with our UK partners in working this. So I think that relationship is very close. And I think it will continue to be close. But I would be lying to you if I didn't say I'm very concerned about the GDP investment, not only in the UK, but in all of Europe. Because we need multinational solutions. And the U.S. is willing to participate and to some cases lead, but we need our multinational partners to help. So I would just say, as we look at these threats around the world, they are concerning to everyone. And I think we all have to be able to invest and work together to solve these problems, because it's good. These are turning in, because of the way information moves and how quickly it moves, it is becoming global issues. They're no longer just state to state or regional, they're more global. Counterterrorism is clearly a global issue. And we should be able to work closely together on that issue. We need everybody to help assist and invest.
Yes.
Nicholas Berry, Foreign Policy Forum. One of the tasks of the military is to provide advice to national decision makers in the White House. That's basically for the military, the Joint Chiefs, but you're very much involved in that. I won't ask you how effective that is, but I will ask you about, are you happy or satisfied with the access that your council has with the White House?
Yes. This is always a question. You know, I believe that we have, so as Chief of Staff of the Army, member of the Joint Chiefs, by the way, I have the authority to any time request a meeting with the President. You know, now we tend to work through the chairman because he represents our views, and that works out, frankly, more efficiently and effectively. But I've met with the President quite regularly on a number of issues, whether it be budget, whether it be issues involving security, and so I think the access and the ability to give advice is there. So that's important. And so, you know, I would just say the way our system is set up, you want a process where the military can give their best military advice on how we believe a problem should be solved, and how we should invest in it. And I would say we have that capability today. It's absolutely taking on a regular basis. And so, and it doesn't mean we always agree, but that's okay. You know, I was always I was always taken by, I always tell this story, and I'll just tell it very quickly. When I first became the chief of staff, General Shali Khashoggi passed away. And we were doing his, we were at his funeral, and we were at Fort Myer, and President Clinton came to speak. And he, as he was speaking, he was explaining his relationship with Shali Khashoggi. And he was saying that Shali Khashoggi would piss him off more than any other person he'd have because he'd tell him things he didn't want to hear. But he says as he grew over time, he realized that he was giving him the best advice because he was giving him honest advice on the most difficult issues. And he really appreciated that. He goes, I didn't always follow it because I had to make, it was my responsibility to make the decision. But he appreciated the advice that he was giving him. And I think that's the point. And I would argue that absolutely we're able to give that advice to the president when we need to.
Yes.
Sheldon Simon, Arizona State University. General, thank you very much for your comments, and Wolf, for your excellent moderation. Turning briefly to the Korean Peninsula, for some years now, the United States has been urging the Koreans to take over the combined command, but the Koreans keep on deferring. Can you tell us about the dynamics behind that?
Well, I don't know the inner workings of that, but I would just say this. I would say that I believe that they simply don't think they're prepared to do that yet, and that they think it's important to still have U.S. leadership. And so I think a lot of it has to do with they want to ensure continued U.S. commitment to South Korea and the Korean Peninsula. I think that's part of it, but I think they still believe that our ability to lead operationally in a multinational environment, we just have more capability to do that than they do right now. But we are working closer and closer towards that. And I think there will come a time here where they will take that over. But I think for them, it's important that they want to continue to see us leading that for at least the next 4 or 5 years.
Is the all-volunteer army the future of the U.S. Army, or bringing back the draft, is that a possibility?
Well, I'm a big believer in the all-volunteer army. I've lived, I came in the army right when it first started, and I would tell you the quality and capability that we have, and because of the diversity of the missions we have to do, the all-volunteer army just makes it easier to do. And I think the professional force that we've developed is the finest we've had, and I think it has to do with the fact that we've had an all-volunteer army. Now, I will say, of all-volunteer army is more expensive. But I think the investment that we put into it makes a huge difference in our capabilities.
Okay. One last question.
Sharon Burke with New America and former Assistant Secretary of Defense for Energy, but I'm not going to ask you about energy. What I'd like to ask you about is, you've talked about new challenges, and you've talked about the fact that the Army's changing the way it's organized and the way it's training, soldiers themselves, that you're changing this. What about equipment? And I know that's been a tough thing for the Army in recent years, yeah. And I think it'd be great to hear you talk about what you're doing with the requirements process.
Yeah, so it's a couple things. Thanks for asking that question, very important question. So first off, as General Sullivan, one of the ex-chief of staff of the Army, I respect, he always says the intellectual always precedes the physical. And that's the case now. So intellectually, we're already making the adjustment. The next piece is how do we physically make that as we look at our requirements process and our equipment process. So the one thing that we are doing is we have now brought together all the different entities that are involved in the requirements process, and I am overseeing it, and we are meeting regularly to make sure everybody understands our priorities and how we're developing requirements for the future. And the mistakes we've made in the past is we had what I would call utopian requirements. And what I mean by that is we would put things in there that we weren't even sure technologically we could achieve. And what that would do is that would cause us to delay programs, to make them too expensive, and they wouldn't deliver what we wanted. So what we're trying to do now is make realistic requirements that leave room for growth. So the thought process is you can iterate improvements into your systems. So you might buy a system, and the first time you buy it, it has this capability, and 2 years from now, you can input new capability, and so you continue to modernize and improve. And so I think that's important. The other important piece to this is, as I've explained, this very complex environment that we're going to operate in, you have to develop, for the Army, we have to develop concepts and then use technology to help those concepts. You can't just say we're going to take whatever technologies out there and develop our concepts to support the technology. And so we've ensured that we've changed that. So part of this is us, as we look to the future warfare, here are the kind of concepts we want to do. Now here are the technologies that are available. And then we adapt and innovate those concepts based on the technology. So for example, manned, unmanned is one I would use as an example. You know, so how are we using unmanned UAVs with manned aircraft? How are we going to use unmanned ground systems with manned ground? And so the concept is, how do we develop manned, unmanned capability for the future? And then what technologies to support it? Command and control. It's clearly, technology is exploding. You know, I tell everybody, I get so frustrated. I can have my iPhone here or my cell phone, and I could talk to every continent right here. I could dial up 5 numbers. I could have a conversation in any continent in the world. And yet right now for me, I got to put 200 vehicles on the ground to talk to anybody. Why is that? So we've got to we got to develop a concept of what kind of communications do we need? How do we protect that communication? And how do we use technologies that are already available to make that better? And so those are the kind of things that we have to do. And I think we are now on the road to doing that. And because we don't have a lot of money right now for modernization, we're going to have to make the best use of every single dollar that we have.
Well, General, I think the mission has been accomplished. We are all a little bit smarter now than we were an hour ago when we started this conversation, thanks to you.
Thank you.
So on behalf of all of us here, thanks very much for joining us, and we'll continue these conversations.
Thanks.